Let's now move on to the third part of our lecture, which is about interrupt handling. So in the previous section, we were acquainted with system calls. A program initiates a system call when it wants to run a privileged instruction, when it wants to read a file or do something like that. That means that we halt the operation of the program, we interrupt the operation, and we invoke the operating system. So this type of interrupt is referred to as a software interrupt because the software itself actually interrupts itself. It stops running and it interrupts itself, or we also call it a trap. So an interrupt is a response by the processor to an event that needs attention from the software, and this guy should have listened when his friend interrupted him. So we generally differentiate between three categories of interrupts. So as we saw, traps or software interrupts are when we have an exception that's thrown by the program call code, like a system call. So the software itself actually interrupted itself. Then we have what we call asynchronous interrupts. So asynchronous interrupts are interrupts that come from outside the CPU, like a mouse click. Somebody asynchronously clicked on the mouse, it interrupted what the CPU was doing up till then. And we have synchronous exceptions, and a synchronous exception is an unexpected problem with the instruction. So for example, if we try to divide by zero or call, you know, an illegal instruction or do something like that, then the processor will throw an exception. So let's see this visually with our first Teman analogy of the day. So as probably will happen a lot with these Teman analogies, you know, anybody who has kids, they're dealing with kids and interrupts all day. So finally, I got the kids to sleep. And now I can wind down and, you know, go and watch the old telly. Damn, somebody logged out of Netflix. So that is, I need to initiate a system call. So I go, I pick up the telephone. I call my wife, who's having a good time with her friends, left me with the kids. And I ask her, you know, honey, what's the password? Of course, the password is 123456. So that was a system call. I initiated this type of a privileged operation, going and asking my wife for the password to Netflix. So now I turn on my show, you know, Formula One, Drive to Survive. I'm hooked on this thing, and wow, look at Max Verstappen go. No, no, an exception. The Wi-Fi crashed. And so that was what we call an exception. Something happened, something went wrong, somebody divided by zero or whatever. And now I need to go and handle it. I need to go and reset the Wi-Fi in my house and handle that exception. Okay, back again. So Sunday race is going to start and got an asynchronous interrupt, something from outside. It's the kid. The kid says, Dad, I can't sleep. And my night, of course, is over watching TV. So what do I do? How do we handle the interrupts? So when we receive an interrupt, we must handle it by the operating system. Handling is done by a procedure called an interrupt service routine, or an ISR. So any of these types of procedures that are run to handle interrupts, they're called ISRs. So it's just a procedure, but it's a bit special because it's an interrupt handler. Okay, so the operating system is invoked. We moved into kernel mode and we call the ISR. For synchronous interrupts, which are traps and exceptions, we do this immediately because really either the software went and said I need to do a system call, or I did something illegal like dividing by zero, accessing a point place in memory that I'm not allowed to access or something like that, and I can't continue running. I have to throw an exception and handle it immediately. But asynchronous interrupts are differently. So somebody clicked on the mouse or did something like that, and they go through a slightly different process. I may not want to handle it exactly right then. So the operating system must decide when to allow asynchronous interrupts. If I'm really in the middle of something really important, I can disable them, for example. So interrupt enabling is an important thing. I can either enable these asynchronous interrupts or disable them. And so when they're enabled, the CPU every once in a while is going to check and see if there are any interrupts that are pending, that any of the devices wanted to actually make some sort of an interrupt. So the thing is that several interrupts may be pending, and if several of them are have been thrown at the same time since I last checked, the operating system will have to decide on which one to handle. So in this case, the interrupts are enabled, and the CPU is going to check for pending interrupts. So it's going to select one of the interrupts, and the first thing it's going to do is going to clear the interrupt to say, listen, I'm going to handle this. I'm going to take care of it. It doesn't need to bother me anymore next time. And then I'm going to disable all the other interrupts so another interrupt won't come in while I'm handling this one. Okay, then I jump to the interrupt service routine, I handle the interrupt, and I return from the ISR, and only then I really re-enable interrupts and continue execution. And remember that between this time when I disabled interrupts and re-enabled interrupts, right, no one else can interrupt things. So I really want to handle this as fast as possible. So I want these ISRs to be short and, you know, do things really at a regular user level as possible. Just do the minimum that they can return from the ISR. And as we'll see later, maybe make a process that will handle things otherwise. So let's talk about vectored interrupts. Which ISR do we actually call when we receive an interrupt? Because different types of interrupts can have, different types of handling we want to do. Some systems have a single ISR that handles all interrupts, and actually RISC-V supports this. But this can result in long, complex code. And as we said, we want to have interrupt handling be really, really fast. So that's not very good. We should really have a different routine that should handle different types of interrupts. So what is the solution? The solution is indirection, of course, like all the solutions to problems in computer engineering. Okay, so let's provide a different ISR for each type of interrupt. So we have in our memory, the first ISR and the second ISR over here. Maybe a reset is a special type of an ISR, and here's our main program and so forth. Okay, so then what we'll do is we'll put in memory something that we call an interrupt vector. So that's basically a table, and the table just contains the indirection that points each type of ISR. So these are the numbers of the vectors according to their addresses. They point to different addresses in the memory where the actual ISR is stored. So each interrupt will go to an actual point over here in the memory, see what the content is, and be redirected over to where the entire ISR is stored. So the encoding of the interrupt points to the table entry that contains this address. And usually, this is an address given to each interrupt in a microcontroller. So for example, over here, we would have 64 vectors. And so each of them was assigned to a different vector. So these are called IRQs often, interrupt requests. So IRQ 0 to 63 are different types of interrupts that are connected to the microcontroller. So let's see how this works. Say I push a button, the reset button, it goes to IRQ0. IRQ0 is redirected to this address OXFF9C. In OFXS9C, it finds the address OX8000, and OX8000 goes over here where I have my procedure for running reset. So the next thing I want to discuss is priorities. What happens when several interrupts are pending? So we see our microcontroller over here has interrupts from reset, from a non-maskable interrupt, from UART, different things are pending at the same time. So the system has to decide which interrupt to handle, and this is often done according to priority. So the pending interrupt with the highest priority will be handled first. And in many architectures, this is just hard-coded to make it easier. So for example, over here, we have 64 different types of interrupts, and we built in that vector 0 will be highest priority and vector 63 will be lowest priority, so we don't have to go and look up the priority or something like that just to make things a lot faster. But is priority enough? And it's not really enough. You know, we may have this thing called interrupt masks, which will disable certain interrupt and enable others. So we don't want some one device to interrupt us, where others we want to allow them always to be interrupting and so forth. So we have what we call an interrupt mask. And there are some interrupts that are like non-maskable. For instance, pressing the reset button, we probably never are going to be able to mask that type of a thing. If an interrupt arrives while another interrupt is being handled, what are we going to do? And what if there are several cores or several hardware threads? Who's going to handle the interrupt? Which one gets it? And so forth. So therefore, we usually use an interrupt controller. And an interrupt controller is usually a piece of hardware that's pretty complex and it's system specific to actually go and decide on what to do with interrupts, especially when we have things like nested interrupts. What if there is one interrupt that's being handled and in the meantime, a higher priority interrupt comes in? Should we mask it, as we said before, when we disable interrupts, or should we allow it? And usually the answer is we should allow it, but that makes things really, really complex. So RISC-V actually defines something called a PLIC, or a platform level interrupt controller, that enables us to handle multi-core or multi-hardware threads. So you see there's this platform level interrupt controller that gets all the IRQs and it distributes them between the CPUs and the threads and so forth according to logic that's built into there. So I'm going to go into handling interrupts in RISC-V, and it's actually quite complex. So I'm going to try to do it real quickly, but you really have to go over the spec if you want to implement this. It gets pretty complicated. So it centers around this CSR called mStatus. Okay, and M status has 32 or 64 bits, and they are divided into different types of sub registers. So the .xie bits are interrupt enabled. So X is for M, S, or U. So we have .mie for machine interrupt enable, .sie for supervisor interrupt enable, and .uie for user interrupt enable. So these are just different bits that are inside this 32 or 64-bit register. So each of them, it allows interrupts or disables interrupts for the whole privilege mode that we're in. Okay, it includes bits to store the previous state for to support nested interrupts. So what happens is if we're handling an interrupt and we get another interrupt, we better know what the previous state was, if interrupts were enabled, disabled, which ones, and what the previous privilege level is. And these are inside this XPIE and XPP bits that are inside the M status register. So there's .mpie, .spie, .upie, and for a previous privilege level, we only have to have for supervisor and machine mode. So, and then we have return from interrupt instructions with MRED and SRED that help us restore the state upon returning. We'll see this graphically kind of in a minute. So pending interrupts are registered, are listed in a different CSR that's called MIP. So these are the pending interrupts. So it's separated into three categories, which are called external, software, and timer bits. So MEIP, that's the pending interrupts for external. The pending interrupts for software, those are SIP. And the pending interrupts from the timer interrupts that are TIP. And there are corresponding enable bits, which are enable for external, for software, and for timer. In the MEI CSR. So we have three different CSRs here that are kind of in this. And we have different CSRs that store other information about the interrupts. Like MCAUS is the cause of the interrupt. MTVEC is an address of the interrupt handler. MEPC is the address of the interrupted instruction so we can return to it. And MTVAL and MTSCRATCH and MSCRATCH are other registers that enable us to store more info depending on how we do these implementations. So let's look at this kind of graphically. So the first thing we're going to do is decide on handling the interrupt by looking to see that global interrupts are enabled, which is with this mstatus.xie bit, UIE or MIE or SIE, right? So mstatus.xie, if it's one, then global interrupts are enabled. Is the type of interrupt enabled? So we have the MIE vector, and we have to look at the type of interrupt if it's enabled. Then we have to see if interrupts are pending. So we go to the MIP vector and see if the type of interrupt is pending for us. So once we do that, we know that there was an interrupt. And then we have to prepare it. We have to decide on which one to use and prepare the interrupt. So what are we going to do? We're going to save the state. So MEPC gets the current PC so we can return from it. MStatus XPIE saves the previous state of the interrupt enable bits. And XPP stores the previous privilege level so we know how to return from that. And then we save data about the interrupt, which is encoded into the MCAUS, MTVAL, and MSCRATCH registers, so that we save the data about it so we can send that to the interrupt handler and know what to do with it. Okay, now we prepared the interrupt. We can go and handle it. And how are we going to do that? First, we're going to squash the instructions in the pipeline that haven't been, gone past this point, because if we have a long pipeline, most of the stuff is just not going to be run after that. It's not going to be correct because we're running to a different procedure. Then we're going to disable interrupts because, again, we don't want to be interfered by at least a lower priority level while we're handling this. And we jump to the ISR by changing the program counter into the handler address of the ISR, and this is encoded with the MTVEC, MCAUS, MTVAL, and MSCRATCH CSRs, depending on how we're going to be using it with vectored interrupts or just one point of execution type of interrupts. And finally, we're going to return from the interrupts with the MRED instruction. So that's the really complicated process of handling interrupts in RISC-V, but if you look down deep into it, it's going to actually support the things that we showed at a higher abstraction level before.